morning, Bethany.
Good morning.
I said, good morning, Bethany.
Good morning.
It's time for our call of worship. Could you please stand for the call of worship? Our call of worship coming from the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 24 to 28. That's Romans chapter 8, verses 24 to 28. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why do he yet hope for?
But if we hope for what we see not, then we do not.
Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered.
And he
shall search
the hearts of the Lord, but the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
All together? And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Let us pray.
Lord, thank you for this lovely morning. We're closing our backs and our forgiveness. They will our pay for
them. Yes, God.
Anybody want to praise God with me this morning? Put your hands together. Come on.
church family. Our brother gave us hymn number 533, Count Your Blessings. How many count your blessings this week? How many count your blessings now? And one by one, count your blessings.
Count your blessings, count your blessings, they don't want my one. chapter, Romans the 12th chapter, starting verse 10, we'll find in the same man.
Amen.
Be kindly affectionate one to another, with brotherly love, and honor, confirm one another.
Not sorrowfully business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord.
Rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, continue instant in prayer. Bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Be of the same mind one toward another as others. Mind not high things, but common conscience to men of low esteem. Be not wise in your own conceit.
Thank you. Say amen.
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. We give praises to our God for another chance to come together and entering these baptismal services to baptize Brother Chris Arrington Bates.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Let the Lord bless him as he celebrates this grand occasion.
You are the best church family. Yours in Christ, Linda Stewart and family. Amen. Next Sunday is our 110th church anniversary. Amen. morning message will be provided by Dr. Delbert Mack.
Amen.
Thursday, November 16th at 11 a.m., the Neighborhood Association and our community councilman, Marengo, will sponsor a Thanksgiving meal at KB Polk Rec Center. All over 60 are invited to come and be served. If you cannot attend, please see Reverend Sam Freeman for a delivery arrangements.
Amen.
Reverend Haynes will be on vacation on the fourth Sunday in November, so Reverend Hare will deliver the morning message.
Amen.
First Sunday in December, Reverend Chris will deliver the morning message. And now we will have a special announcement by Mona Simpson.
Luke chapter 11, verse verse 42, it states, but now as for what is inside of you, but generous to the poor, and everything will be clean for you. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
church say amen?
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
Amen. Give praise to our God, and we're so thankful for your presence. Just good to be in the Lord's house one more time. Give God some special praise right now. Let's praise him for our young people blessing us today. Yeah. I'm in shirts today. Look out. I was supposed to have one too, but I'm waiting for Chastity to bring mine. She's sitting in church. Right? She said, don't get dressed till I get there.
Blame that
up, okay. Look who's talking. Look who's talking. It's too easy. Yeah. Anyway, we thank God for the privilege. Oh, I got the shirt on. The shirt says, Pastor, warning, anything you say can be used in a sermon. Hey, you know, my sister Linda gave me that. She thought I was smaller than I am, but I had to wear it anyway because I like that machine line. Anything you say or do, I can use it in a sermon. Right. Give God some praise for our minister of music and the gospel. Excited about it.
Those names up there already?
That's Bible study.
What about, oh, you want me to tell them you're doing Bible study?
Yeah, that's on you.
I'm so glad you let me have it. For Bible study during the day session, we're going to have Sister Carol Pettaway?
Pettigrew.
That's what I said, Pettigrew. I'm trying to speak with that stuff. She done gone already? Well, she's going to preach. I mean, she's going to teach that day session noon. And that night session, brother, you're doing the 29th of August? You're doing the 6th? Okay, so that means Chastity, sister. sister Destiny gonna be doing the blessing. Promising young ladies, she's going to do that lesson on the 29th, and I want you to pray with and for her. We have another surprise with her, but that's way next year, so we're going to be there along right now. On the 6th, it's going to be same person day session, but that night session with the Chris is going to pray that Brother Stanley Clint McKinney is going to do that lesson for us that day session. I'm sorry, he's doing the night session. And Chris will do the day session. Let's do the birthdays. I told him to tell you to get up as soon as I came out here. He would have to wait on you. He's supposed to already be down. You gonna stand up right there? You can stand up there after you go down and let us sing. Step it up so the ladies can see you get some hair.
Dance with three ladies.
Do you have that film on when he's dancing with three ladies? He acts like he can't go down when he got to do something. But this Negro was dancing with three ladies at one time at his class reunion. He ain't told nobody what he couldn't do. And he talking about he don't want to go down, and you know he ain't shy. He's going to be in the center of attention every time.
And I do believe
that. God has been so good to him, don't give him no money. He don't need no money. Just pray for him. Just pray for him. Just pray for him. Brother John Jocelyn's birthday is today. Give God some praise. Reverend Samuel Freeman. It's Sister Gunner here today?
Yeah.
There she is.
She okay for not
mine. I'm sorry. Sister Gutter. Sister Gloria Gutter. Come straight out the gutter. Sister Gloria Gurley, I'll give God some praise. What's your name, baby?
Reese.
Right, come on, Reese. How old are you, Reese?
9.
You gonna be 9 on your birthday? It's today. You made 9 today. Y'all give good Sister Reese a great amen. Praise the Lord. Sister Gloria, just hold your hand up. All right, let's sing happy birthday to my birthday candidates.
Thank you.
Thank you.
chapter 12, that whole chapter can help you, but we'll just focus on verses 10 through 18. Romans chapter 12 and verse 10. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another, not slothful as lazy, in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind, one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men.
Yeah.
If it be possible, as much lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. For a few minutes, I'm going to talk about the analogy of a tree. Make sure you put it on there.
Yes, sir.
With this sermon.
Yes, sir.
I want y'all to read that. That really touched my heart. She, the Lord is really doing some great things in her life.
Amen.
With her and mine. I'm just glad to be a part of it. I want you to read that. Not because of what it says about me, but because of what it says about ministry. Mm-hmm. And pray that God will continue to bless her life and her ministry. Amen.
Amen.
Analogy of a tree. I didn't get that. Tyler Perry is responsible. He okayed a movie entitled Maxine's Baby. Tyler Perry. Maxine's Baby. He was on television shows promoting it, and of course, you know, that Tyler Perry had kind of a long life, but in his book, he talks about higher weight. He talked about this fact that a tree really is a strong analogy for the Christian life. And a tree really kind of depicts what has happened in his life. He basically talks about three parts of a tree. He talked about the leaves, the branches, and the roots. He mentioned that the leaves are that which is representative of people who are in your life temporarily. They're not meant to stay. They aren't meant to be in there all your life. You have some people in your life that they come into your life and they contribute to your life. They provide shade for your life. They make contributions, but don't become totally dependent on them because they aren't going to be there always.
Yeah.
It's like when a rocket goes up to go in space, after it gets so far, the boosters fall off. It's not a reason to panic. It's not a reason to get upset. It's just that as far as the boosters can go, and you got to understand that there are some people who are in your life, but they weren't meant to go all the way up with you because they can't handle the higher heights. You can't allow your compadres to determine how high you fly.
All
right.
That God wants to take you higher than some people want you to go. God wants to take you higher than some people can go with you. Talk about the branches, and the branches, of course, is a little longer than the leaves. You know, the leaves, when the wind blows, they go. When the seasons change, they go. And you know that we all have different seasons, but the branches, they'll last a little bit longer than the leaves. The branches will be there in your life, and you can probably get more support from them and with them, but don't get too attached to them because they too aren't meant to be there always. Learn not to get too mad and upset with folk when they can't stick with you. They're not mean. They really don't mean you any harm, but they're only being who they are. There is only so much some folk can do. You can't get mad because some people aren't spiritually strong enough when they're not spiritually strong enough. You'll get it on the way home. That I've got to understand that some people are doing the best they can, but their best is not good enough to last where I'm headed. But then talk about people who are the roots. These are the underground roots. Are not there to be seen. It's not there to try to brag on themselves. Roots is that part of the tree that really contributes most to growth. It's unseen. It's strong. It's not there to brag on the roots. Most people haven't even seen the root in a tree. But the tree wouldn't be the tree without the roots.
Right.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
He talked about that. He dealt with this matter of in his own personal life. He contributes his mom, his mother, to being the roots in his life. She's the one who greatly contributed to him having the kind of life he had. He says that she was the one there speaking into his life, building his life. She's the one who really introduced him to God. She's the one who taught him what prayer was. She's the one who helped him to see God. He was saying his mama had a kind of a rough life. She was abused by her husband, his daddy. He was saying his daddy wasn't a particularly wicked man. It's just that he didn't have a daddy himself. And he was really quite abusive, not only to his mama, he was abusive to Tyler. He was saying he was raised in this kind of house, in this kind of environment. And really, when the man, the old man came home, it really wasn't a whole lot to look forward to, but a whole lot of pain and nepotism. He saw his daddy brutalize his mom, beat his mom, abuse his mother. He saw him just saying one negative thing after the other. He was raised up with these folks who didn't believe in being too nice to children. And he was just the opposite. He was saying how that negativism could really work against a person. But he was saying he grew, he learned not to let him become negative. He said eventually his mama told him something about prayer and how you can talk to God about it. Told him how you could pray and ask God for that which is the impossible. That he was wondering, is it right for me to ask God to stop my mama being abused? Said he taught him how to pray, and he starts praying, and he would hear voices, and these voices kept pushing in the right direction. He used to say it was voices, but eventually he grew to the point that he recognized these weren't just voices, these were the voice of God. Yeah. Then he kind of opens up and he talks about his spiritual growth and development, how God came into his life and how God started to guide him. And you know, when God is in your life, he'll guide you into directions that inherit some nepotism.
Yeah, yeah. Say it, say it.
Oh, yeah. Don't think that because God is guiding you, everybody's going to be on your side. In fact, it's just the opposite. God can drive you into some areas where you will inherit some enemies you didn't have before.
Say it.
And he said, so he was going, and y'all know how he eventually had this vision, and he had these plays. These plays came in his mind, and his plays started to grow him. He started to succeed to some degree. He was saying how his plays were basically both focused on black people. Black people. And he was saying how when you focus on the needs of black people, you in a class minority. You got some folk who don't want to see you do things that's going to help black people.
Right.
Some of y'all got a problem with that. I know he talked about y'all. He said basically there are two kinds of black people that kind of give up on us. He said there are some black people who don't have anything.
Right.
They're kind of like he was. He was raised, didn't have a whole lot to put together. He was poor. He was just barely making ends meet. He said he was used to that, but he rose above that because he found out when you have God on your side,
yeah.
He found out that God can supply some needs.
Yeah.
God can give you comfort. He can give you peace. We talked about that. But he said these other black people. He said there are some black people who have everything. They're educated. They live in nice neighborhoods. They're doing well, but they don't want you doing nothing for black folk because they're too busy trying to deny their blackness. Yeah, I haven't been used to that. And I used to think some people just get mad at stuff I say, but I found out a lot of them kind of get insulted when you insult the fact that they don't like blackness. They're so busy trying to be white and be accepted by the whites and be accepted by that society. Anytime you got something that's pro-black, they got a problem with you. Yeah, I see y'all climbing right now. So he was saying how, but he learned not to allow the nepotism to work against him. He said when he started trying to get his movies, his plays in the industry, they didn't like it. Thought he was crazy. That stuff can't sell. You can't sell black movies. You can't sell black plays. You're pointing to the wrong audience. You got to get more broad.
Right.
He said after he had his plays a while, people said, well, what you gonna do to widen the scope, to make it bigger? And he said he never intended to make it bigger. Because what he was doing is what God showed him needed to be done. Oh, it got quiet. That's my sermon. I'll let y'all go. But he said something that got me. He says, Lord started blessing him. Y'all know how he blessed him. His plays became movies. His movies became successful.
Yeah.
And he got an audience. He started making money. But he was saying how when God really started to let the money come in, his mama died. And when his mama died, he lost his motivation to make more money. I know that money would break that. And he lost his motivation to make more money. I'm gonna start there. Talk about motivating mission. Motivating mission. How is it? They said, What is it that you did when your mama died and you lost your motivation? He says, for a while I was lost. She was my motivation. He said, I didn't realize it, but I've been making money. But the only reason I was focusing on making money is because the more I made, the more I wanted to bless her. When we were struggling, when she didn't have ends, we weren't able to make ends meet, I promised Mama I was going to take care of her.
Yeah.
I'm going to buy you a house one day. I promised Mama, she saw a car, a Jaguar. And he said, I promise, Mama, one day I'm going to buy you that car. He talked about how he had promised her certain things, and in his mind, he was a little boy. She said, yeah, babe, I know you're going to do it. And so she was saying it, but he don't know if she really believed it. But to him, that was always a dream.
Yeah.
To him, that was always a goal. Yeah. But when his Mama died, he realized he got a whole lot of reason for me to make some more money. He realized he already had too much money. He kept trying to make more while she was alive because he was always afraid that something would happen and then lose everything and be poor again. He was afraid that things would go wrong. He wouldn't be able to support her. But once she died, there was no reason to need more money. He says, I already have more money than I need. I want y'all to see this. He says, he lost his desire to make more money. That might be hard for some of you to understand because some of you feel as though money can solve all your problems and you believe that the more money you make, the better you're off. But the fact of the matter is, a lot of people who have money aren't really all that happy.
Yeah.
I was talking to a comedian, he was saying how he got to the point where he wasn't going to be like other comedians because he realized that a lot of folks just keep trying to make money. He said, but you know what? In the final analysis, you got to understand you can't take it with you.
Yeah.
You can take more money, but that's only so much money you can spend. What you're trying to do, you're trying to be something to somebody else. You want to get $1 million, then you want to get $1 billion, and you keep trying to get higher and higher. But the final analysis is no matter how much money you make, there's only so much you can do with the money.
Right.
And the money don't mean you'll be happy. It just means you have more money. So he said, I decided I'm just going to be a comedian. Tyler Perry said, I decided that I couldn't please Mama anymore, so I had to do something that pleased God. Wow. Let me just stop right there. I want you to get this straight. Perry, he wasn't saying that his Mama meant that he was tired of ministry. He wasn't saying that his Mama was his motivation for ministry. He said his Mama was his motivation for making more money. You see, your drive to succeed is not always just to make money. Sometimes your drive to succeed is trying to impress somebody else. It wasn't until my daddy was dead, my Mama was gone, that I realized that receiving awards didn't mean as much to me when they were gone, because in the back of my mind, every award was a compliment to them.
Yeah.
And it helped put them on the back that I couldn't be who I was had it not been for them, and you couldn't praise me without praising them at the same time. But what do you do when they're gone? What do you do when they lay down and they cross to the other side? You need another motivation. You got to have more than just Mama and Daddy. You got to have more than just their memory. What's going to keep you going?
Yeah.
He said, you got to learn how when things go bad in your life and you have no more motivation of that kind, you got to understand how to let God motivate you.
Yeah.
That's what true ministry is all about. That's what helps you keep your focus, that you're not about trying to please people, you're trying to. I think that's what the Apostle Paul was up to when he starts saying that, you know what, you get to the point where you understand that living for Christ is more important than just I wish I had a business. For me to live is Christ. And for me to die is him.
Yes.
Then I understand that if I have Christ in my life, that's all I really need. But don't you understand, you heard me read it, that when you have Christ in your life, he says, don't go around trying to promote yourself.
Yeah.
When you have Christ in your life, you don't go around trying to elevate yourself. You don't go around trying to promote yourself. When you have Christ in your life, you learn how to focus on being humble.
Right.
You focus on, how can I help somebody else?
Yeah.
What can I do to help somebody else?
Yeah.
What can I do to help make somebody else's life more meaningful?
Yeah,
your motivating mission, that you got to have something that drives you, that motivates you to do that which is pleasing in God's eyes. Meditating and moving into ministry is what I focused on next, because when Tyler looked at it, he learned to use God's blessings in order to bless others to go to a higher level. I'm going to say that again. He learned how to use God's blessings to help others go to a higher level. That you got to grow to the point where you understand that we are here to use the blessings God gives us. To be a blessing to somebody else. Let's see if I can make it more relevant, and you'll see where I'm coming. Y'all know he has this studio that he designed and made, and he was saying how when his mama died, the studio was still growing and making, but he noticed things were doing well, and some folk was trying to get him to change his focus. He said, no, this ain't the time to change the focus. This is the time for me to be more focused. And he said how he paid Sidney Tyson $1 million for 1 hour of work. He said he had two young actors. He gave them $1 million apiece when their agent only wanted $500,000 for them to perform. He said, the reason he did it is because this was the growing rate for actors. But there was a difference in how they treat black actors and how they treat us. You know the actors, they can get millions of dollars. Those actors in Friends, they got $1 million an episode. They got a story that they stole from Living Single. They didn't even want to give Living Single credit for stealing it, but all of them got paid $1 million an episode. And now they make money on getting y'all to eat worms, so all you can get is $100,000 at the end of the season. He got quiet then, You don't see the distinction that there's a difference in how they treat us and how they treat everybody else. And Tyler Perry said, well, I decided instead of me criticizing the other industry, instead of me telling them what they aren't doing, I decided I'm going to show them what to do. I'm not going to tell them what they're doing wrong. I'm just going to start doing right. I'm just going to start treating people like I want to be treated. I'm just going to start focusing on black lives. That there are some stories in the black neighborhood. That you don't have to change in order to be acceptable, because there are enough of us in the neighborhood to know that that's real life. Talking about how he was struggling, and one night he put on the dress and came out and became Mud Deer. And he noticed Madea was supposed to be a supporting character, by the way. He said he wasn't one of these shaky fellows who got sugar and liked to wear dresses. He was saying that he just did that to do something, and he found out she stole the show. Instead of being a supporting character, she ended up being the star of the show.
Yeah.
And so before he knew it, the whole audience was full of folk coming just to see Madea. I wish I had a witness here. But he was saying how that people like Madea is famous because really it's not just the man in dress. Madea really represents what's real in a lot of our lives. That's true.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
If the truth be told, all of us got a big mama in our lives. All of us know somebody who don't say what's politically correct, but just say what's on their mind.
Yeah.
And all of us know somebody ain't trying to be accepted by the majority. They just gonna be who they gonna be. And what he's saying is when you tell the truth, you gonna have an audience, because everybody eventually gets to the point where they see themselves, they will declare that it is the truth. All Tyler really was trying to say is stop trying to be somebody you're not, and start being who you be.
Yeah,
you're gonna always fail when you start trying to play white when you're not white. And I got a problem with white folks who don't want to be white. Not quite, but ain't nothing worse than a white person with a wig on, got a rope in it like y'all got. And you're trying to pretend to be somebody you're not. Be who you be. Yeah, I know you are, it's right, but I'm going to say you can always be you, and you don't have to worry about trying to play somebody else.
Right.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
All I'm trying to tell you is that God is still in control.
Yeah.
And when you don't do what you're supposed to do, God will find somebody to get his will done.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here that the Lord can make a difference? That's what the Apostle Paul was trying to get us to see. He was trying to see that don't let negativism make you negative. He said you ought to bless them that curse you and do good to them that despitefully use you. That you ought to be the demonstration of what love is all about. That you can't tell folk about love, but you can show them what real love is. Yeah, love make a difference. Love can lift up a bowed down head, and you know what? You can't really expect the devil to be loving. It's not in his makeup. The devil is too selfish. He is the author, he's the chief of all lies. So if you're talking about lying, the devil can help you there. If you're talking about trying to undercut somebody, he can help you there. But when you're talking about love, you got to go to the origin of love. Where can I find some love? He said, God is love. God can make a difference in your life. So Tyler testifies that if it wasn't for the Lord on my side, oh, help you, Holy Ghost. And you'll say it's more blessed to give than to receive. You know, a lot of folks don't know the joy of giving. And when you stop going around trying to pull folk down, and you're going around trying to lift folk up, I wish I had somebody. You learn the joy of helping somebody. And if I help somebody else get a little higher, as soon as God starts elevating them, it brings the joy to my soul. Nothing like getting happy when God is blessing somebody else. Ain't nothing like finding joy and seeing God bring joy to somebody else. That's why Paul is in prison and he's there telling the Philippians, don't feel sorry for me. In other words, you need to rejoice. You ought to be glad. You know what? Because God has taken my affliction and caused it to be a blessing to the cause of the saints. In jail, but don't feel sorry for me, because even in jail, God is blessing me. I got my naysayers, that's the folk who don't mean me any good, but even when they're preaching against me, they don't realize they're helping me, because every time they preach against me, they start calling his name. And anytime you're blessing Jesus, you're blessing me.
Anytime you lifted up Jesus, you lifted up me. He said, you ought to be glad. He said, whether they're trying to pull me down or whether they're trying to help me, the bottom line is that the Lord is being preached. Stop getting jealous in church because somebody's voice is better than yours. If somebody's saying amen, you want to say amen too. Don't get mad because somebody can preach and everybody likes to preach it. If they can give glory to God, you want to give glory to God too. Yeah. I don't care what your attitude is, that if you're on the right side, you ought to be on God's side. And if you're on God's side, he can make a difference in your life. I wish I could stay right there. That's some good news right there. That you ought to celebrate the joy of loving the Lord. Before I move to the climax, there really ain't no climax, but I want to say, is there anybody here know the joy of serving the Lord? Is there anybody here that experienced the joy of walking with God? Has anybody here that experienced the joy of the Lord waking you up in the morning and starting you on your way? You can have a broke pocket, no money in your pocket, but you got the love of the Lord in your soul that makes you feel rich on the inside. You got a hoopty for a car, but you got a limousine in the kingdom. And the Lord, I wish I had it. He might not give you a car, but he can get you where you need to go. I wish I had it.
Show you what the Spirit of God really is.
Do I have a witness here? Is there anybody here allow the Holy Spirit to overrule your wants and causes you to live like he told you to live? Yeah, he said, by this will men know that you are my disciples because you love one another. Yes, don't fool yourself. Loving one another is not easy. Yeah. Y'all want to lie about it. I'm going to tell you the truth. Loving one another is difficult because a whole lot of us are just plainly unlovable. Yeah, you know, church folk can have some ugly ways. Yeah, man, church folk can be real negative. Church folk can be so negative, you wonder why God don't just zap them with lightning and knock them down. But be careful asking God to strike people down, because when you start telling him to strike down the wrong folk, you might be struck yourself. You might be struck down yourself. No, you got to understand that that's when the love of God really is powerful. When he loved the unlovable, when he loved those who don't act like saints, when he loved those that's got flaws and, yes, problems and negativism. Yo, those are the ones that you got to call on him and say, Lord, help me to be a Christian. Help me to love sister so-and-so. Help me to love brothers. I know they're always digging ditches for me, but Lord, help me to be a blessing in their life. And then he had nerve enough to tell me to pray that they won't fall in the ditch they dug for me, but that he'll help us keep on climbing to higher and higher heights. In other words, he said you got to learn how to not only thank God for your roots, but he got to bless you to be a root in somebody else's life. He got to use you to get to the next level. Yes, Tyler said his mama was his root, but who's the root in your life? His mama was his blessing, but whose life are you blessing? And if you're not blessing somebody's life, you're not being who God told you to be. There's only so long you can just be a babe in Christ, but eventually you ought to grow up. Yeah, you need to grow up and let God have his way. You ought to grow up and make Bethany a better church. You ought to grow up and stop trying to find fault with somebody else and just come on out and say, it's me. It's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. I need you, Lord, to lead me and to guide me. I need you to help me to make the world a better place. We're living in a world that folks say, I don't know how we're going to fix this problem. We got so much hatred, racism, and negativism. I came by to tell you, I know how we can fix it. And you know how we can fix it? We can fix it. Yes. Instead of asking God to fix it, just ask God to fix us. Instead of asking God to make it better, ask God to make us better. Lord, yes, help me to see what you want me to do. I can't make JP do it. I can't make Sam Freeman do it. But I can get Haynes in straight. I can get him to let God have way in his life. So, Lord, here I am. I surrender my will to your will and my way to your way. Have your own way. Have thy way. Have thine own way. You're the potter, and I'm the clay. Shape me and mold me according to your will. And I'm not, stop to give you the glory. I'm not stop to give you all the the praise. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? If it had not been for the Lord blessing me, I wouldn't have anything to brag about. I told you a long time ago, I had to grow up spiritually and stop bragging on me. But anytime I feel like bragging on Haynes, I decide I'm going to brag on Jesus. Before I start trying to lift me up, I keep lifting him up. And you know what I found out? If you lift him up, yeah, he'll make a difference in your life. If you lift him up, he'll keep drawing folk. If you keep lifting him up, he keeps making a way out of no way. If you keep lifting him up, he'll make the sun to shine on all of your darkness. Is there anybody here who know my Jesus? Is there anybody here who know my Lord? If you know him, say yeah. If you know him, say yeah. He's worthy. I say he's worthy to be praised. Now excuse me, but I think you ought to have us, yeah, one of them holy parties. Now, we need to have us a hoorah party. We need to have us a Holy Ghost party. I think we ought to give him some praise right now. I love Holy Ghost parties. Because what I like about Holy Ghost parties, it will ever stop. What I like about Holy Ghost party, all you need is to have some Holy Ghost in you. And the same Holy Ghost you have in you, he'll put running in your feet. He'll put clapping in your hands. What I like about Holy Ghost party, you may decide you aren't going to say anything, but the Holy Ghost in you, I think you lift up your knees. The Holy Ghost in you, you put running in your feet. He'll make you clap your hand. The Holy Ghost in you, he'll make you say, yeah, yeah, amen, hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Give him some praise. Tell him yes. Give him some glory. Tell him yes. Give him some honor. Tell him yes. Say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For one more day. Thank you, Lord. For letting me be in the service.
Spiritual condition, growth, and development. They
ask you to go to God on their behalf. And so we would gladly call their names and gladly beseech God's guidance and blessing in their life. If you're here today and you didn't send out the note and you didn't tell somebody, but you know that you want God to bless you right now too. Now's the time to tell him. You don't have to tell him, you just tell him. He knows all about it. He knows how to bless your life. I'm going to ask you really easy to come and offer the prayer, but as he prays out to me, I'm asking everybody to go to God and ask God to bless our needs. Sometimes we have shortcomings. We're not even smart enough to know what we need. But he knows all. If you're here today and you want to beseech God, want to approach God, now's the time. I like the way the old people put it, Lord. They say, have a little talk. Have a little talk.
All right.
prayer and benediction. I didn't want to give that much of a notice, though, but I got to give this in fellowship. You stay right there, you all right. And I also give a communion. And I'm just so glad to have him. He doesn't just come when he gets baptized. He comes every Sunday. When his mama bring him. You want that, you can do that.
Looking back at you.
He's going to be a new member class, bitch. Yeah. They got a pretty lady now too, so I just look at that and that good. Be all right. We're gonna take care of it. We don't let the old people do nothing to you. And God will get the glory from your life. I just feel like God's gonna really bless this young man in a magnificent way. Shall we stand for the benediction?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, dear Lord. We thank you for the words that have been spoken. We thank you for our pastor, dear Lord. We ask you just to continue to just bless him. We thank you for our new member, Chris, dear Lord. And we ask you to just provide guidance for him in his young life, dear Lord. We thank you for all of our members. We pray for traveling grace to the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Everybody's there.